Hello and welcome to Comic Book Conversations, where two towns meet to talk about their love for comic books and graphic novels. I'm your host, Scott Golodner. With me tonight is Paul Castiglia. For over two decades, Paul has been writing and editing comics for companies such as DC, Dark Horse, Archie, and others as well. Additionally, Paul has had a hand in marketing and promotions for Archie, and he's one of the company's foremost historians. A collection of Castiglia's Archie's Weird Mysteries comic book stories will soon be released, and he's also working on a book about classic horror comedy films from Hollywood's Golden Age. Welcome, Paul.
Thank you.
My other guest tonight is David Levin. David is a television producer, head of Brainstorm Inc., and a comic book aficionado. Welcome to you, David.
Thank you, Scott.
Let's start off with Paul. You know, I think every comic book fan is always thinks about what they could do to get into the business. How did you get involved in it?
Well, I've always just been into comic books. From the time I was little, I was drawing things I saw on TV. Somewhere in my parents' attic, there's still little notebooks with Huckleberry Hound and Yogi Bear. So I knew all along that I wanted to do this. And I got into superheroes early. So I was a comic book kid. There was no stopping it. I just knew what I was going to do, and I was determined to study it. I ended up taking Saturday classes at the Joe Kubert School, and also some night classes there as well. And ultimately, I ended up going to college at the School of Visual Arts, which has a great, very good comic book and animation program. But I kind of came into comic books through a different route, because when I graduated from college, I realized I was not as skilled in the areas of composition and anatomy and perspective as I needed to be to compete in the business. It's a very competitive business when you're trying to be an artist. But I was able to draw well enough to put a story across. So I ended up putting together a portfolio of picture scripts, and I caught wind that one of my old teachers, Joe Orlando, the great writer and editor for DC Comics, he was starting to edit Looney Tunes magazine for DC Comics in the late 1980s. So I dropped off this portfolio with him. I said, "Oh, Joe, do you remember me? Here's some things I've been working on." He did remember me, and he said, "Oh, sure." You know, it was only 2 years out of school, or maybe a year out of school, and he said, "Yeah, I'll give you a shot." So that was my first published writing. Shortly after that, I got a job as an assistant editor at Archie Comics, and I spent almost 10 years on staff at Archie, and an additional, I don't even know at this point, it's been 21 years altogether in my association with Archie. I've been freelancing for them since mid-1999. So I go back a little ways with Archie.
Sure. I mentioned in the introduction that you're coming out with a collection of Archie's Weird Mysteries. Now, you've written those issues?
Yes, there were 34 issues altogether. It was based on the animated series that was popular for a while, where Archie and the gang would find themselves in kind of X-Files / Kolchak the Night Stalker type situations.
Or Scooby-Doo situations?
Sort of. Well, I always kind of I steered people away from that, because that was a typical criticism at the time. And I would always point out that, you know, Archie and the gang were actually meeting a real vampire or a real werewolf. It wasn't, you know, some evil landlord trying to do something.
It wasn't old Mr. Higgins
to
get the mind shot.
I would have gotten away with it if it weren't for the kids and hot dog.
That's right. So we did 34 issues of that, and there's a collection coming out of some of the best stories that should be available in comic shops by mid-July and in bookstores by August.
And here is one of the issues.
That was the first issue.
This is the first issue. And, okay. So are these comedy stories, or are they more adventure stories?
Well, they're a mix. It really depends. We kind of ran the gamut. Some of the stories we did with Scarlet, the vampire girl / vampire hunter, those were a little bit more on the serious side. But then there were other stories where I came up with the idea of having an intergalactic baseball game. So Archie and his friends had to teach the Smeltoids how to play baseball so they can finally beat their rivals from the other planet. So some of the stories were just based completely on just trying to be funny. And, you know, I draw a lot of inspiration, too, from things like Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein, So it's kind of all over the map, but people really liked it. It had a nice following. Fernando Ruiz did the art, and it's just really one of the better things I've been involved with, and one of the things I'm most proud to have been involved with.
I understand you were involved in one of the biggest storylines in Archie, which was the love showdown in the 90s. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Oh, sure. It was a time when they were doing the Death of Superman over at DC and some other things. The Death of Superman is the one that sticks out the most. And at the Archie company, I was on staff at the time, they said, we need to come up with something comparable and spike some sales. So we had a big meeting about it, everybody in the company, and we were bouncing around ideas. And I put forth the idea, well, what if Archie decides he's going to choose Once and For All, but he won't really make that decision? And I had suggested, because I had been researching stories for the Archie Americana volumes and had come across these stories with Cheryl Blossom from the 1980s, who was this vivacious redhead that Archie got involved with. I said, she's been gone for a while. Why don't we just kind of bring her back as a surprise? And that was my major involvement with it. I didn't write the stories. The great writers Dan Parent and Bill Gallier took the ball and ran with it, and they really fleshed it out. So I can't take credit for the stories, but the germ of the idea was mine. And then I ended up promoting it, and it was the first time in a long time that Archie had pretty much worldwide coverage on something they did. And it took something, you know, just as big as Archie getting married 14 years later to kind of reach the same level. And that actually surpassed the Love Showdown by a huge margin. But still, you know, everything begets something else.
And I assume
Showdown led to the Archie Gets Married.
I assume in the Love Showdown he didn't actually pick anyone despite the...
No. He ends up with Cheryl Blossom at the end of the story. So then they just spun out a whole 2 or 3 years of further storylines out of that, right, where now it wasn't just a love triangle, it was a love quadrangle. So,
what do they see in him?
They see freckles. And a tic-tac-toe pattern.
Freckles and a tic-tac-toe pattern. See, that's the thing
that's
with
right.
Archie. I knew. I wanted to get the tic-tac-toes when I was younger. And I just...
Your barber could never do it for you?
My barber could never do it for me.
Okay. Yeah, I don't think many high school kids end up in this situation where they have all the most beautiful women in the school just fighting for them like that.
Maybe Big Ethel.
Big Ethel. You mentioned that you edit the Archie Americana series. What exactly is that?
The Archie Americana series was a series of books that ran from 1991 through this year. There were 12 editions in all.
Mm-hmm.
It covered each decade in Archie Comics history, save for the present decade. There was the 1940s through the 1990s. There were 2 volumes for each of those decades. And what we did was, what I did was really research. That was my main task on the project, was to research all these stories from all these years. I had to look through, I can't even tell you, countless bound volumes of every Archie story that was ever published to find stories that really reflected each decade and suggest them to the other editors and the publishers and say, these are the stories I think should go in here. And it was just a lot of fun, you know. And doing that research, you come up with things like, oh, this was the first appearance of Reggie. This was the first appearance of Pop Tate. So you find those, you isolate them, and you put them in there, and the fans love it.
Did you ever see that story where Archie's car breaks down?
Yes, I have seen that multiple times, as well as the story where he's late for class, and as well as the story where he makes a date with both girls for the same night and the same time, but doesn't realize it.
That one was my favorite.
I think you're confusing that with Three's Company.
Oh, maybe. Or Gilligan's Island.
Maybe.
No, I'm pretty sure it was Family Ties.
Family Ties. Could be any one of those. Now, you've had a role as an archivist, historian for them.
Yes.
And you've put together a collection on the characters.
Well, this is actually a book this was a story that was written by the great Fernando Ruiz, and it was drawn by Fernando and Bill Galvin. It was called A Night at the Comic Shop. And currently, Archie has in the process of trying to introduce a lot of the classic characters that they had published in the 1940s and 50s and 60s, but that are a little bit more obscure. So they did a great job reintroducing the characters in the storyline, and they asked me to come up with sort of a who's who write-up for the back of the book, which kind of gives you the history of each of the characters that appear in the story. And it's a lot of fun, and you're going to see more of that in the future from Archie. They've brought back Sam Hill as a digital comic, I believe, and that's gone over really well. They're bringing back Cosmo the Merry Martian, and there's a few other things in the works, some of which I may be involved with.
Great. Speaking of things that you're involved in, I understand that there is a comic book-based charity that we've mentioned before on the show. Could you tell us a little bit more about it?
Yes, Superheroes for Hospice. It's a very special charity. It was created by Spiro Ballas, who works for St. Barnabas Hospice in West Orange, New Jersey. And he is the volunteer coordinator at the hospice. He's also, like us, a big comic book aficionado. And he decided, wow, maybe I can put my collection to good use and help raise money for the hospice, for all the people that help out. Because there are a lot of expenses, you know, when you're dealing with hospice and volunteers. So Spiro came up with the idea in 2009 to start holding sales for this, and it's been a really good success. It's been running for a few years now. The way I got involved is that my wife saw it mentioned on BaristaNet, which is a local website that gives news about Essex County, and her first thought was, hey, you can sell off some of your collection. We can have more room in the house. And then she started thinking about it more. She goes, well, this is like a really, really good charity. Maybe you can get involved even further. So I contacted Spiro, and I volunteered to appear and sign copies of my comics and give all the proceeds to the charity. And that's developed further into me being the creator coordinator, which means I basically call upon a lot of the friends I've made in the last 21 years in the comics business and say, hey, would you like to show up at one of Spiro's events and sign some comics and give the money to charity? It's a great cause. So the next one is coming up on July 16th. It runs from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. and it happens at 95
Old Short Hills Road.
Thank you.
Right across from St. Barnabas.
That's correct. And Spiro, we'll be happy to talk to you about how you can be involved if you want to donate or if you just want to attend. And I believe you'll be superimposing Spiro's information.
Is there a website or anything on it? Or
I think he has a website on the main St. Barnabas site. If you go to the St. Barnabas main site and you search for the hospice, you'll find Superheroes for Hospice on the site.
And we'll post some information on that. And if there's any creators in the field who want to donate either their time or artwork or their comics or anyone else wants to do so, they can contact him.
It's a great time, you know, and one thing I also want to point out about the sale, well, for creators, first of all, we all get to hang out and have fun, but for people who are really into comics, especially if you just started by seeing a movie, you can really build up your collection inexpensively at the sale. These comics from all decades at really, really good prices.
Great. Well, thank you for telling us all about that, Paul. We'll be back after a couple of minutes for Scott Golodner. Sorry. Combo Conversations, this is Scott Golodner. See you in a moment.
After 17 years working as a mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
Hello, and welcome back to Comic Book Conversations. I'm your host, Scott Golodner. I'm talking with my guests, David Levin and Paul Castiglia. During the break, when I was speaking with our guests, David brought up a good point that just as Paul had mentioned that Joe Orlando helped get him in the industry, he also had a similar effect with David. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, I can. It's funny because I got into the industry also because Joe Orlando loves to sort of mentor people. He mentored a lot of people. Paul Levitz was mentored by Joe Orlando. So a buddy of mine who worked for Mad Magazine called me up one day, and I work in the TV industry, but I had been at one job for a while, and he knew I was into comics, and he said, well, there's an opening at DC Comics. Do you want to go? So I figured, okay, what the heck? So I went over to DC Comics, and Joe Orlando was there. And Joe Orlando, who was in the industry forever, and was one of the great artists for Mad Magazine, and he had drawn a Daredevil issue early on, and then for DC, he had created gobs of characters and done revitalized House of Mystery and House of Secrets, and the Spectre and Jonah Hex, some of that stuff. So Joe Orlando was sitting there, and I go in for my interview right around lunchtime, and he's sitting there having a sandwich. And I sit down, and I go in, I'm all sitting there ready for my interview, and sitting there all straight, and he says, and he bites into his sandwich, he looks at me, and he says, "So what's the funniest movie ever made?" "Airplane." He said, "What's wrong with Young Frankenstein?" I said, "Young Frankenstein's good too." So I went to, did a little bit of work for Joe Orlando. I worked at DC for about a minute and a half, and then other stuff, life sort of took me in other directions, but I became a freelance television producer, but I also did some freelance work for DC Comics for a while, and that led to some relatively interesting experiences.
Really?
I have on my resume, two comic books and a story for Looney Tunes magazine. We're probably in the same issue or something.
Probably are.
We'll go home and check.
Can I see your resume? Because I'd like to see that.
It's on the web. You can look it up. And I told them that I wanted to do some writing. So I did a thing for a Justice League International, what they called bonus books at that point. And that one was drawn by Dean Haspiel, who's gone on to great many mm-hmm. wonderful things. And then I had a very strange assignment that became almost a legendary story in fan circles.
Specifically your family?
My mother was very, very happy.
Your fans?
My fans. Okay. And there was a kid in England whose dad was a multi-gazillionaire, and he was having his bar mitzvah. So this guy commissioned a Superman comic to be written and drawn featuring his son to be given out as gifts at his bar mitzvah. So I wrote it. And
they turned to the best writer they had.
He
was unavailable.
Exactly right. Exactly
and
right.
You worked for free.
I worked for very little.
Okay.
But the story was drawn by Kurt Swan.
Wow.
Who was the preeminent Superman artist from the 50s through the 80s. I mean, there's just, you know, listen, a lot of people have drawn Superman in the last 25 years, and John Byrne did the revamp, and a lot of great artists have done Superman. And certainly Joe Shuster and Wayne Boring were great. But Kurt Swan was known as the Superman artist. None compared. You know, when we were growing up, if you saw a picture of Superman, you knew if it wasn't done by this guy. You might not have known, but he was like the best. Like, there's the best Archie artist. This was the best Superman.
Well, in fact, I think in the Smallville TV series, the character that Christopher Reeve played was called Dr. Swan
after Kurt Swan. Correct. And it was drawn by Kurt Swan. So just having Kurt Swan draw something that I had written was just amazing. And I had written in a couple of weird, crazy things. And the inker was a guy named Angelo Torres, who was an artist for Mad Magazine. And the reason they had him ink it was because he was able to do the likenesses of the kid and his friend. And the kid had a horse and a dog and a mother and a father. And just
kind of like Superman. He had the super dog. Super monkey.
The character in the book the actual kid playing himself?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so it was the kid playing himself. They brought him in for a guest shot. Okay. So the name of the family was Bradman. So I came up with a title. I named it after This Island Earth, and I called it This Island Bradman. Okay, fast forward 25 years. Now this 13-year-old is now...
Is this the book here?
This is the book.
Hold that up.
So it has become, it's like one of the rarest Superman comics ever printed.
Because it wasn't released to the public.
And people, and so I I was blogging. I started a blog, and I decided I would put my blog up. Turns out it's like this holy grail of really major fans in the know who want this comic. I got an email from somebody who wanted to pay me $2,500 for a copy of the comic, because it was like 100 in existence.
And again, that wasn't your mother.
It wasn't my mother or my father.
Just making sure.
No. They got free copies, so they could sell it for $2,500.
You're holding out for $25 million.
I am. I want to buy a house. So $2,500 might not. It might be the closing costs. So it's pretty amazing thing. And I started posting pieces of it on my blog, and that's my claim to fame in the world of comic book writing.
Wow. So we have two industry veterans here.
Yes, I'm truly a vet.
That's how we got the gray hair.
That's right. That's right. It's stay in school, kids.
Your hair will never turn gray.
Your hair will never turn gray if you just stay in school. So that's my claim to fame. But I've been a fan for a long time. I mean, there's a lot of great stuff going on in comics these days.
Well, this is the summer of comic book movies.
It seems like it's always the summer of comic book
movies.
It
seems like it is.
But
we have five comic book movies out this summer. We have Thor, X-Men First Class, Green Lantern, Captain America, and Cowboys vs. Aliens.
Right.
Which is from a much lesser known comic book.
Which I never read.
But the previews of it look great.
It looked great.
You mentioned to me that you saw Thor.
I saw Thor. It's hard to say. I saw Thor. I had a good time. I mean, it wasn't the Thor, but it was a Thor, and it was pretty close to what, listen, anytime you put something on screen that's done, that was originally by Jack Kirby, you're dealing with something fun. I had some issues with some of the things they did, and they're always going to change the comics and screw them up a little bit. But
I think part of it was done with the reboot that J. Michael Straczynski did. They based the story, some of it, on what he did.
Yes, they did, and there's no Donald Blake. Donald Blake is mentioned in passing, but there's no Donald. But Jane Foster's there, and Sif is there, and Heimdall is black, and Hogan. I keep thinking Hogan's Heroes, but Hogan. Grim is Asian. So it's a multicultural Asgard,
which is great.
Which is great, there was no Balder. I will notice that, but Anthony Hopkins as Odin. That's pretty good.
That's pretty awesome.
They're pretty good with getting the major casting. And Natalie Portman, come on, it's not a bad thing.
Good thing they got it before the Black Swan came out.
Yes. Well, yes, of course.
Paul, did you see the movie?
I did see Thor.
Did you enjoy it as well?
Yeah, it was a good popcorn movie. It's hard now because, look, a lot of movies raise the bar. You have the Christopher Nolan Batman movies. The second Spider-Man was really well done. There was some resonance to the first Iron Man. So those raised the bar, and then everybody, or critics, I should say, expect each succeeding film to either reach those heights or be better. I don't know that it's possible,
It's interesting. Years ago, I did a special for MTV and interviewed Stan Lee, which was like having an out-of-body experience to hear Stan Lee. And he said, for years, no one was able to do the Marvel Comics justice. You could do Superman, you could do Batman, you could do Wonder Woman, because they were basically, but the Hulk, he was like this, so they got Lou Ferrigno in the 70s, but it wasn't the Hulk, it was just a big muscular guy painted green. And for millions of people, that was the Hulk.
Right. And the less said about the Spider-Man TV series of the 70s, the better we are.
The better.
That was pretty off.
But now they can do special effects that they couldn't do then. And Stan was thrilled because they could do justice to the characters. They can have a Human Torch flame on. They can have a Silver Surfer. I mean, script notwithstanding about some of these things.
Right.
But you can have Thor and you can have a Rainbow Bridge. Didn't look quite the way I thought it would look. But you can do
that. I mean, if all the movies were made by Pixar, they'd probably all be 4-star movies.
Well, right. It's The Incredibles.
The Incredibles is, it might be.
Great Fantastic Four movie.
The Incredibles is a fantastic.
It's the best Fantastic Four movie there is, really, quite honestly.
You've never seen the Roger Corman one, then?
Oh, I have seen it.
I have seen it.
Well, that one they made a few years back was the same movie.
Yeah.
With only slightly better effects.
Yes.
For the money.
They weren't even better effects. I thought I liked The Thing better in the Corman movie.
What I think will be interesting is the Captain America movie, because since that's set during World War II and he's essentially fighting the Nazis, though I think they might be just referring to them as Hydra instead. It'll be
we beat Hydra in World War II.
Hydra in World War II, not the Germans.
This is the first shot out. You know, and they tried.
But it'll be interesting to see these characters going around shooting machine guns at it when this is not your typical, you know, kids movie. It's I'm sure rated PG-13, but it's going to be people shooting machine guns at each other, the good guys, during that.
I'm just very happy that they're sort of getting the fact that there's a reason why the comic books have been successful for 50 years now. Those Marvel comics. There's a reason why the DC comics have been successful for, you know, 75 years. Because the initial kernel of truth was there, and when they get away from it, like the Spider-Man musical did, you know, Uncle Ben is hit by a car instead of being shot by a burglar. Okay, I'm going to go out.
That was his whole motivation.
His motivation was he didn't stop the burglar in the comic, so now his motivation is going to be he's going to go after scofflaws who park bad parking tickets. Stop you! You're speeding.
You saw the Spider-Man musical, right?
I saw the first iteration, so that, you know, I saw like the second preview.
And you liked it?
I wanted to like it. There were parts of it I liked.
You liked the first act, but not the second.
I loved the flying sequence. Did you see Spider-Man?
I've not seen it.
The flying sequence is Spider-Man landing on the balcony right in front of me. That was great. You know, it was like a 5-year-old all of a sudden, but kind of like now. But the music, not so great. I'm looking forward to sort of seeing what they've changed. I've heard it's better.
President Clinton liked it.
President Clinton liked a lot of things.
Yes,
so.
He did.
Leave it there.
Which are inappropriate. But anyway, I do want to touch on, you brought your iPad with us.
I did.
And you want to be, just have about a minute left, so if you just quickly show us.
Sure. You know, reading comics, we've been reading it in print for so long, but this is a great way to sort of read comics now. Let's see. I've got to find them here. All right, comics.
I should have had this prepared before.
I should have. Well, I did. Okay.
We were just having too much fun.
We were having too much fun. So if you take a look at this, you can see, if we read one of the comics, it takes a little while to get to where you want to go. But I look at my comics, and here's a Spider-Man comic. And the cool thing about it is that, you know, you can read it like a regular comic, and it's pretty cool. Or you can go in on it, and it'll read one panel at a time. So, it's pretty neat.
So the companies more and more are expanding into these. Some of the DC and I believe Archie have same day distribution on digital purchases, and Marvel is having somewhat of a delay, but that might change in the future.
Yeah, and DC does it also, and Archie does. You know, and you know what I mean. If you're going on a long trip or a car ride or something like that, it's great because you don't have to bring a stack of comic books. It's a nice way to read them that wasn't available when you were growing up.
That's great to know. Thanks for sharing that with us.
No problem.
I'd like to thank my guests David Levin and Paul Castiglia for being with me here tonight for Comic Book Conversations. I'm Scott Golodner. Good night.